Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear participants of the 2010 World Water Week in Stockholm. On behalf of the United Nations Environment Programme, I would like to thank you for this opportunity to address you this morning and to share with you a few thoughts that both reflect the lessons of, as you have called it, 20 years of the World Water Agenda, and also the experience that UNEP and many of its partners have gathered over the years in trying to address the challenges of managing water supplies and water resources in a world that is increasingly confronted by changes both in terms of consumption patterns, by the impacts of consumption and water use, and also by the phenomena that we now associate with the changes imposed upon us, such as climate change, loss of ecosystem services, and the growing number of people and the growing number of cubic meters of water that are needed every day across the planet. In addressing these issues, we can look at many technical parts of it, and certainly at this year's World Water Week, you're going to focus particularly on wastewater and sewage-related issues that have often affected our water supplies and also affected the quality of water supplies to cities, to communities, and to nations. However, from the perspective of trying to look at the bigger picture, I believe that we are still struggling with trying to integrate the water agenda in the broader context of both our economic, social, and environmental systems. Therefore, one of my messages that I would like to share with you is that I think the systems perspective remains one that we often articulate but have not yet elaborated sufficiently in terms of trying to bring the decisions, the changing parameters, and also the policies that are necessary to reflect that understanding into the mainstream of resources management, particularly water resources management. Quite clearly, from the perspective of UNEP, the ecosystem perspective is a central part of our approach to trying to address the future supplies and availability of water. Water comes from somewhere, it is used by humans along the way, and it goes somewhere, and very often that cycle, in the way that our governments, our institutions, our market is organized, do not necessarily reflect that system's approach. We manage water in institutionally fragmented contexts. We manage water also in terms of responsibilities that do not often acknowledge that the ability of one party to affect the capacity and the ability of another party to use that water supply are really central to trying to make water resources management more sustainable. Clearly, the challenge is not just one of a theoretical systems perspective, it is trying to translate that approach to understanding the economic, social, and environmental systems that ultimately govern and determine the way we use water in a more effective way. UNEP has, over the last 2 years, launched a green economy initiative, and you will be hearing more about this throughout the week. One of the central assumptions in that green economy initiative is that we must connect the understanding that science has provided us in terms of what is happening to our natural resources, and in this case to water supplies, with the economic signals and systems and policies that determine the decision-making and consumption behavior of our economies and societies. In the green economy initiative context, it is also trying to understand how economic signals can change the approach to using water. Clearly, in a world that is confronted not only by a growing population, soon 9 billion people in less than 3.5 decades' time on this planet, increasing water consumption per capita, and also the prospects of climate change and their disruptive impacts make this task even more important and urgent. Clearly, trying to understand the science remains not a completed project, and certainly we need a further and more detailed understanding of how water resources management in terms of its ecological dynamics can be better mainstreamed in terms of water management policies. But the linkage between the science and the ecology to the economy and our economic signals, I think, are a central challenge of our time. Our economies, our societies, consumer behavior are ultimately determined by economic signals. Those economic signals are not only a matter of market prices, they're not only a matter of market forces. We need to understand, just as in every other sector in our society and economy, that markets are structured. And the way these markets are structured will ultimately also determine the patterns by which these resources are conserved, used, and reused. At the moment, the ecological footprint of water consumption on the planet is destructive in two respects. One, we are depleting water resources both through direct extraction and also by destroying the very ecosystems that provide for that water supply to be assured. The loss of ecosystem services has been documented by many reports, not least the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, but also many other pieces of analytical work and research that have been done in universities, think tanks, and not least through the partnership of UN Water. So on the one hand, the very resource that we rely on, that this meeting is focused on, and that we also have to focus on in terms of many of our economic sectors to continue to thrive, is being depleted and diminished at a time when we know that the consumption needs are in fact increasing. The second part of the challenge is also to look at the wastewater impact, the cost of how we transform clean water into dirty water, create from an economic asset an economic liability that translates into health impacts, into pollution, into deoxygenated zones in our oceans affecting fisheries and marine biodiversity, are a trail of destruction, if you want, of also irresponsible action at a time when knowledge really has already been sufficiently clear for us to choose a different course. Many of you are water professionals who have spent sometimes decades trying to bring both the science and the management lessons of recent decades to the attention of society and policymakers. Just as in the climate change arena and very often in the broader environmental sustainability arena, we have to acknowledge that our success has been limited. One of the key areas, I believe, in which we can make some progress is to document really the economics of water use as it occurs on the planet today. We are often confronted in the arena of water resources management, as we are in many other natural resources arenas, with the fact that the consumption and use by one group does not necessarily capture the cost and the impact on another group. That is why, in looking at the water resources management challenge of our time, is very much one an approach that requires a systems perspective. Ecological systems clearly is something I have already referred to, but it is also a matter of social equity and also of economic rationalism. This year marks also the 10th anniversary of the World Commission on Dams, a report that to this day remains a subject to intense debate, and also a report that tried at the time to try and capture the use of technology in the context of water resources management from these multiple perspectives. We may still disagree about some elements of the report, but I believe that one of the fundamental assumptions in that report that are central to us being able to manage water resources more rationally, more effectively, more efficiently, and also by consensus, should be one of the messages that also has to be part of the way we address water resources management in 2010. Water resources ultimately are an asset that is shared in society. We know already today that in terms of transboundary dynamics, but also in terms of communities sharing water supplies between upstream and downstream communities, and also different sectors between agriculture, industry, and urban water consumption have created many tensions. In many parts of the world, we can see that unfolding tension articulating itself in conflicts over water. In some parts of the world, economic solutions are being sought and developed. To take the Murray-Darling Basin example and the water trading approaches that have been developed there is certainly one response. And it is not to reduce the notion of water resources management to economic apportionment or allocation rights and to make these tradable in a marketplace that will provide us with the only answer and approach. But I believe it is one illustration to demonstrate that societies have to confront the challenge of an ever scarcer resource and also a ever more expensive resource to provide to our societies being located in a broader understanding of how economics can help us to make that equation work. It is therefore one of the approaches that UNEP has taken in trying to contribute to the world water debate and also to assisting countries and communities in addressing the challenge of water resources management, that we hope with our Green Economy Initiative to provide some more of the analytical and also policy experience that will allow us to address some of these challenges that are often economic, environmental, social, and redistributive. But the approach that we need to take is not the commoditization of water. That was a simplistic answer of a decade ago. Trying to bring the economic rationale in line with an ecological perspective and also a social equity approach is going to be central to trying to create a consensus around the future management of water resources. Clearly, in a world where a sector such as agriculture is still responsible for 70 to 75% of total water consumption, the question of the role of agriculture and the future of agriculture is going to be central. I'm disturbed by the way that we look at the challenge of food security and food production in the future from simply a perspective of increasing the current production models simply by expanding quantity of area and also quantity of irrigation. We have to start to understand that water has a price, not a price in terms of a tradable commodity only, and not a price only in terms of the entrepreneurial sector becoming more engaged, but it has a price to society, it has a price to social stability, and ultimately it has a price to economic and ecological viability. trying to bring these elements together, I think, are going to be central to achieving the kind of not only social and political consensus, but also conceptual and practical managerial framework that will allow 9 billion people to share in the available water resources and to begin to understand that it is not only about how to maximize current water use that we have to focus on, but rather how to optimize water use across the planet. The notion of reducing pollution is going to be central to that. We still treat water in many parts of the world as if it is an expendable commodity once it has come out of a tap or out of an irrigation pipeline. We know today that water courses and also water in terms of sewage and wastewater have become carriers of enormous pollution impacts. These are unnecessary. Neither industry nor national economies should allow this to continue. Much of our work in UN Water is focused on trying to address precisely these irrational signals that continue our societies, economies, and also the industry to behave as if water is really an issue, the responsibility for which lies somewhere else. Water has to become the responsibility of every actor, beginning at the household level and ending really at the level of macroeconomic planning and even finance ministries. This, I think, has to be a central message that also the World Water Week this year needs to provide more focus and more guidance on. If we cannot bring these different segments of our economic and social reality to act in greater cohesion, then indeed we may be meeting in 2020 and still be discussing the same phenomena that have brought us together over the last 2 decades in trying to elevate the World Water Agenda to a central natural resource management challenge, but also to a central part of our sustainable development agenda. Let me end by wishing you a very successful Stockholm World Water Week. And certainly we in UNEP look, as we do every year, to the World Water Week to provide us with guidance and interesting ideas and signals in how we can further refine our contribution amongst many towards a more successful implementation of a sustainable water resources management approach. The world urgently needs it, and certainly the price that many are beginning to pay across the planet for lack of action and perhaps also ignorance and complacency is becoming greater every day. Thank you.